So today we are going to start with looking at TestNG framework. What is TestNG? TestNG stands for NG stands for next generation. Okay, it is basically used for writing all the test cases that you do, which could be a unit test case, integration test case, a regression test case, or whatever kind of scenarios you want to write. So for now or so far, we have written main. And in the main, we had defined different functions, and based on different functions, we executed a certain use case, right? That's what we did. Now, we will do the same thing, but a little differently. Now, when I say little differently, you will see that, let's look at the formal definition of TestNG first of all. So if I go here, most of the information I'm trying to share as much links and URLs as possible with all of you. So where is TestNG? So I hope I have shared this link with you already. This is on my website, wherein I have list of all the resources, consolidated list of all the resources that you all need So if you go to the courses here, if you go to Selenium resources, in this particular place I have put a lot of links which I have shared with you already. I'll update it with more things as and when I get time. So one of the links here is easy to type test. Okay, so this is the official site of testng.org. So this is TestNG is a testing framework inspired from JUnit and NUnit. Maybe you might not be aware of what is JUnit and NUnit. So it's a framework which helps you do unit testing, but introducing some new functionalities that make it more powerful and easier to use. So I mean, there had been TestNG which had been in market for a long time. It had been very successful, but TestNG is a next generation which took the best of existing framework and gave us few more facilities, features, which we will see. Okay, now this is the page I was talking about. I have put in where you can download the Selenium server, where you can find the documentation, Java documentation, Selenium HQ. This is the official website of Selenium, right? Firefox. So you can maybe bookmark this page, or you can copy these links or do whatever you want to do. So now coming back to TestNG, first of all, what we will do is, did we set up TestNG on our machines? Last time we did, right? So I believe that we all have TestNG plugin installed on your Eclipse. So we will start with creating our first test case. Now, so if you go to Windows, if you go to Show View, here if you go to Others and if you type TestNG, that option will be there. Okay, so if this option shows up properly, that means it has been configured for you, otherwise not. Is it clear? Everybody, can you find it? Show view. Okay, now maybe tomorrow we will talk in details about Maven build tool, but as a good programming practice, I mean for now I'll call it a good programming practice, but tomorrow when we look at it in more details, it is more of a standard convention which we tend to follow in industry. I'll talk about that later on. Let's not get into that. So you will see that I have maintained two folder structure, SRC test Java and SRC main Java, right? So all of my Java related file will go here, and the test cases will go here. All the test cases will go here for me. All right. Now we will get into details of why it is SRC test Java, SRC main Java when I'll talk about Maven, but for now, you can create, right click here, you can say new and you can create a source folder. There is a source folder and a folder here, right? So what is the difference between these two? The difference is that it is in class path. Class path we understand now, right? Class path meaning that the JVM will, or when you are running the program, the Java will find it in the class path and will execute it for you. Is that right? Okay, so we will get into details of this later on. For now, let's start with the basic of TestNG. So let me create a basic test case. Now, since you have the plugin already in your machine, you can simply go new and say other, and you can type test TestNG, TestNG class, and say next, and then you can choose some of these annotations. Okay, but I don't use this way, it's a personal choice. You can go ahead and do that. So I have just created a simple class here. We are all aware about, we all know what is this class, right? So let me go ahead and delete all of this for now. Okay, now once I delete this, here I create a method. I'll call public public void test one, I will call it, and I'll open close bracket. Now it is not very different from what I have been doing, except that there is no main here. But something special which I'm going to do here is I'll put @TEST annotation here, and it is shouting means compile error is there. I'll click on this one and I will say import of test. Okay, so I'm not very sure if you people have the jar files of test. I think so, you have it. Okay, just please go ahead and wait one more minute. So once you come in here, you will say inside that sys out of sys out, I'll say hellowrld, right? So if I right click and run as, you will see an option to run it as TestNG rather than a regular test main method Java application. Here you will say TestNG test. So if I run this, okay, so you saw that it shows passed as name of the test case, and there will be one additional tab here. The tab is this one. Okay, you will see that it is green in color if the test case has successfully passed, right? Okay, so let's do this much and then I will go ahead. Please try this, all of you. All of you, I don't think so, you have jar files. So what I will do is, you all have access to internet, right? I will give you, okay, you guys continue if you have not done what I am just explained. I will give you some jar files. Open project. So I have just sent you a link on the group. Please take that link and download the zip file, unzip it, and add the jar files. You know how to add the jar files, right? Yes. So unzip it, copy it in the lib folder, and include it in the class path. Please do that quickly. Okay, so we have already added the plugin. I'm skipping this first part, right? We have gone to the Eclipse marketplace, or another way was there, I have told you. After having done that, now what is TestNG, let's talk a little bit about TestNG, a little bit of theory before we actually get started. So TestNG does not require you to have a main method, right? So far we had been writing a main and then executing the main, and also method need not be static. So who will tell me that why the main method is static? Why is main method static? We are what? How many days into this class? And you still are not answering confidently. After a few weeks, we will be done and then you will say, sir ne to ye bataya nahi hai. What is the purpose of static is that when JVM calls the main, it does not have to create instance of that class, right? Yes, no?
Yes.
You knew this answer, right? No? Now you know it. Please, guys, please. Because now I don't see you people active on the group again. See, it's not about TestNG, Selenium and all that. Everything is Java here. Okay, so please bring your focus back to Java. Skip doing Java as and when you get time to do. So the next thing is, why is main method public? That I also know. Yes. So see, you have to put the answer convincingly in the right way. You have to say that if it is in any package and if it is public, JVM can call it, right? Public is visible to everyone. If it is not public, it will give a visibility error when you run the program, isn't it? So we have already discussed all this. Why I'm asking you to continuously read on net, read interview questions, because these questions have been asked and they have been answered. That's why I'm continuously telling you to go back and have that discussion happening continuously. Don't wait for the last, Saturday, Sunday to come back and start talking about it. You have weeks time, spend 15, 20 minutes or whenever you can, okay? Now, TestNG method need not be static. We use test annotation. Test is used to tell the method under it that it is a test case. So this is an annotation. I'm not going to go into the detailed discussion of annotation, but annotation is basically giving some kind of instructions to JVM. So with this annotation, the JVM knows that this is a test case. Okay. Now since we are using annotation in TestNG, we need to import this. Why we have to import it? Because this could be a class which is available in this package, right? Then we use assert. Assert, I'll come to it in a little while. So we have just created a single test case here. Okay, don't worry about this. Here I said @test and then I right click and run it, right? Now once I run it, what happens? I get an output that test is passed and I get a success here. I mean, if you go to this tab here, this is a TestNG tab. Now this tab will only occur for you if you have installed the TestNG plugin, right? So this is a very simple test case. Now let me undo and take my original file. Now original file was like this. It had three test cases, right? I'm saying that for now, I'm saying that I have this one, I have this test case, three test cases are here. Now, what does a test case do? Test case does some validation, right? That's what we do in testing. So I have to verify, or I have to assert that whether a value which I was expecting and the value which I get is same. So let's say you wrote a program, I hope you remember that driver.getTitle. So suppose you get title, so that is the actual value of the title you have got. And expected will be something, right? So you say there is a concept of assertions in TestNG where you assert that the two values are equal or not. If it is equal, then the test will pass, else it will fail. So in this case, I am not doing any assertion, so this will always pass, right? So if I want to end, now when we were creating five methods using a main class, if I had to run only one, I used to comment the rest of the four methods, right? But here what I can do is I can double click only on the method, right click and run as. So I can choose to run only that method, right? So only one ran here. But if I right click on the file and run as, if I say here testng, then can we see three of them executed? If you come back to this tab again here, here you will see that it shows three test cases executed, isn't it? And here on the console it was showing you that it has passed, is that right? Here it was showing that it is passed. Let's say we fail one of them. So I say A equals B, so this will fail definitely, right? Here I am hard coding the values, but in the real scenarios this is got to be the actual values and the expected values. So let's run it. So I'll right click, run as testng. So can you see one of them has failed now? So if I go here and choose this particular one, here it will also show me the reason of its failure. Can you see reason of its failure is that expected B but found A, is that right? Now so far I mean, if you are doing testing, then you also have to do report generation and maintain the report and all that, right? Otherwise your testing is as good as not having tested it. If you cannot quantify it by putting it in a Excel sheet or a test case or some other tool to monitor it, right? So what I will do is, now I'll go to the directory where my project is. Okay, I'm first refreshing it. I'll right click and go to the directory where the project is. I'll go here, and then inside this, if I go, there is a folder called target output created. If I go inside the target test output, there is a file here called index.html, right? If you double click this, you will see that all the report which, or the output which got generated, is this. So out of this here, if you will click on different links, that there are three methods that got executed, out of which one failed and two passed, right? Now if you show passed method, it will show you this is the one which is passed, this is the one which is failed. If you click at this one, this is the one which is failed with the error. Or you can click on the chronological view. The chronological is the order in which they have got executed, right? So this gives you a nice snapshot of all the test cases that has got executed, what are the different tests, what are the groups. We'll talk about all this in some time. Plus you can choose to ignore some method, how we do that, all that report can be seen here. So this is a nice and a customizable report which you can share with your management at the end of the day once your test case execution is done. Are we clear so far? Yes, every time it gets overwritten, so you have to make sure that you save it or back it up after your test case execution is done. Now there is one more file here which is emailable report here. If you open this, this is a snapshot of what has all happened. So test was how many got passed, how many got skipped, how many failed. So if you see, the failed one is showing as red, the pass is showing as green, and the cause of the failure is also shown here. So if you have one more method which has failed, the count will change here, right? And the total time taken. So this is like a pretty report which is generated, which you can use at the end of the day and understand what exactly has happened with your testing, right? So can you all please, and don't take a lot of time, you have already written a single test case, try to assert it with the correct value and create one more method, assert with the wrong value, and try to execute and tell me what happens. Okay, so it is auto generated, I didn't create that file. Go to your project in the Explorer, go to test output folder. Okay, so we will continue further. So we have done assertion, we have done testng execution. Now testng is a very powerful thing which lets us do a lot of things. Apart from that, at the rate test annotations, there are a lot of annotations available in testng. Some of the annotation is before suit, after suit, before test, after test, before group, after group. There are a lot of things we can do. So there is one called before method. Okay, so what it happens, it runs before each method. So if you have 5 methods or 5 test cases, before, after, before, after, before, after of each. So let's say if you want to take some action before a test case, so let's say you are doing validation of a first name. Before doing validation, you want to do some kind of a setup, for example, then you can use before and after. So let me show an example of that one for you. So if you will go here, in the, this is all in Bitbucket. If you go to annotation here, so we will first of all look at before method, and what was that? It was before method and after method, right? So if I run this before method and after method, so what output should we see? So for the time being, I will comment before and after. Before test and after test I have committed, right? And I have only 2 methods. So what is the output we will see? Before execution of this method, I'll see this before, and after this, I'll see this after, and then again before this, I will see it, and I'll see the other one. Is that right? Who did not understand it? Okay. So before each method, if you had to take some action with respect to, let's say, loading of the page, or let's say clicking here, or whatever you want to do, you can call that particular action. So let's try to run this particular code. Run as testng. So let's see the output. So you will see this was the method. Before that there is something, and after that there is something, right? So one set is done, then another method before this and after this. So these annotations are letting you execute certain situations, certain scenarios before and after of each test case. Then there is before test and after test. So let me comment this for now. So this was method. Then what is before test, after test? Before the execution of any test case and after the execution of all the test case, right? So if I run this, I will see before and after only once, and in between I'll see these two. Is that right?
Yes.
Right click, run as. So can you see once here and once here? Yes. And then there is something called before class also. Okay, so before class is when the class, before the class gets loaded into the memory, and after the class is loaded, after the class is removed from the memory. Okay, so there are a couple of options available. I'll give you a link of official, in fact I have already told you which one is that. So this is the official website of testng. You can read about all these annotations which are there. If you go back here, where is the annotation? Yeah, so all the annotations, where are they? Okay, if you go back here, so if, okay, so it's loading again. So all this which I have shown to you here, all this is available on the documentation. Okay, so you can play around with more of this whenever you get time, with different permutation and combinations. Then next thing which we are going to look at in testng is this we have seen. Then there is a concept of priority in testng. So suppose you write test case 1, 2, 3. By default, how will it execute? It will execute in the order in which the names of the test cases will appear in the dictionary. So if it is A and B and C, then first A will execute, B, the order in which you put in file is not important, but if you take the name of that test case and put it in dictionary, that order is important. Is it clear? Yes, no? Who has doubt on this one? Okay, so what I mean by that is, let's say I have test A, B, C. If I put C, B, A, then what will be the output? Yes, alphabetically it will be displayed. If you put all the test cases in a dictionary, in that order it will execute. But it can happen that I write a test case where in test case 1 I say open browser, second is enter username, enter password, and then click button, right? So what will happen? Enter will happen after click because C is before B. So let me show an example to you for this one. So if you go to and all these test cases are available on Bitbucket. I have already given access to you. Okay, so let's say I have this test case with no priority. I have an open browser, open door, launch Google, perform this, Facebook, right? So which one will happen? L will happen before this, right? So you are launching a browser before even initializing the driver. Is that right? Anybody has any doubt on this one? So depending upon the order of the test case, order means if I take this name, this name, this name and put it in a dictionary, the order in which it will appear in the dictionary, in that sequence it will get executed. Yes? So then what I can do, I can put a bracket here, right? How do we pass an argument? Using circle bracket, right? I'll go inside, I'll pressing control space bar, and it shows me what all options are available. I say PRI priority. So do you see a priority tag? So I can say priority is 0, then priority 1, priority 2. So that way we can alter the priority of the test cases, which will determine the order in which it is getting executed. So let's take a look at priorities example here. So here I said priority 1, 2, 3, 4. So now it will execute in this order of first one, then second one, then third one, and then fourth one. Is it clear? What is inside this? Don't worry about it. That's, you can put any use case, but is this concept clear? I'm coming to that. So I can have a 0 priority as well. 0 will happen before 1, and I can have negative priority also. Okay, now in that case, if I have two test cases with the same priority, let's say, then what will happen? See, that is something which is decided by the developers of the framework. Now, suppose this is a big file, okay? You go ahead and put some method in some location in between. Suppose it has hundreds of methods. Then if you have to decide that whether I should put before two methods from the bottom or from up or between 25 or 30, it will become very confusing, right? How would you know that where you should put all the new method which you want to add to the file? If you have existing file with 100 methods, where will you put the next one and how will you decide in which order it will get executed? So the simplest solution is, initially simplest solution, if there is no priority, alphabetical order, right? If you put that name of that function in a dictionary, the order in which it will appear in the dictionary, it will get executed. So first we are talking about this is for only this class. If it is another class, it is different. So if it is this class and let's say it has 10 methods, okay? Now I put method 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I have 10 methods. Now I want to add one more method. Where should I put it? Should I put it after first or second or third? How will I know? Okay, fine. But that becomes very problematic if the file is very huge, right? You cannot decide whether you should put it here, because name, now then you will have to worry about alphabetically. Suppose it is AABBC, then somebody puts AB, so you will get confused in terms of whether this should have gone here or it should go here. Rather than you worrying about it, the framework takes care that whatever name you put, I'll execute it in alphabetic order. But it also gave you flexibility that if you don't want that to happen, then you can override it with a concept of priority. Is it clear? Now, the next thing is, it might so happen that you might want to skip execution of a certain test case. Okay, so let me go here. So this is another test case with priority this minus 1. So this will execute first and this will execute second. Yes. So if you want to pass two arguments to a method, what do you do? First argument, comma, second, right? So if I want to pass something again, ENA, there is an option of enabled equal to, if I say false, then it will not execute this test case at all. Yes, so if I run it, only this one will run. Is it clear? So, okay, so please quickly try these two parameters. One of them is priority and one is enabled, and let me know. Okay, so next thing which we are going to look at is continuation with TestNG. So there is a concept of parallelism. I had told you what is a thread, right? We had spent a good amount of time discussing what is a thread and all that. So, and one of the powerful feature of TestNG is that you can execute multiple test cases in parallel. I mean, that's what we are trying to achieve, right? You want to do a lot of things parallelly. So let's see how we can achieve that. Now this code, I will mail it to you. Please don't type it because it will take time, or if you want you can go to Bitbucket, or rather I'll send it in the group to you. So let's look at parallelism. First of all, we look at method execution of methods in parallel. So generally, if when you check the code in Bitbucket, please take some effort to give the names to the packages and classes properly. So Shraddha, if you will see, I have highlighted this com c2t testng parallel methods. Yes, so just by looking at that package, I know where to find what. Okay, so when you become a automation tester, make it as a practice, so that even when you check in, it is easy for me also to understand what you have put where. Otherwise, I'll struggle to find out that what question you are trying to ask and which assignment. So if you have to say, maybe you can say com whatever assignment one, in that give the name of the class as some proper name so that I understand what that assignment is trying to do, right? So let's go inside this file. So okay, so here I have three methods, 1, 2, 3, right? And in each of this method, I am trying to display the ID of this thread. This we had already seen in the threading, right? So if I run it, right click and run as, what ID we will get? Is it same ID or different ID we will get? Any other answers? Sorry? Why? So what? Did you guys revise the threading concept? If main calls and from main I call the run, is it the same thread or different thread? It's same thread, right? Yes? So you want to change your answer now? Somebody is calling it, that somebody's ID we will get, right? Why Hina, it was because it is different method, it will be different thread. Okay, so let's try to run this program and see what is the output. Run as test ng. So do we see ID as same for each of them? 111 here, right? So what does it mean? It is the same thread who's executing three test cases, but my intention is that I want to run more than one thread so that my work can be done in a less amount of time. Is that right? So I create this XML file here. Now how do we create? I will explain to you later, don't worry about this. So I have a suit. What is a suit? Suit is a collection of multiple test cases. In a suit, I give a name to the suit and I say I want to use parallelism using thread. Let's first understand it, how it works, and then I will tell you how to write this XML file. Okay, so how many threads are there? How many threads are there? One, right? And I'm saying that I want to run methods in parallel for which name of the test case is my test and the class is this class, right? So what it means is that for this class here, take the methods and execute it with a single thread. Doesn't it mean like that? Yes, no, Atveer? Anybody who did not understand this? Okay, so let's run this. So when you create an XML file like this, and once you have the TestNG plugin, this is what happens. Right click, run as TestNG suit. I'll run it. So what is the output again? Can you see the same ID? Yes, no. Now let's do it in more than one thread. Okay, so I'm going to say thread count to 2. Now what will happen? Will the output change? What will be the output? How many IDs will be there? 1, 2 or 3? 2 or 3? Yes, because I have said that I want to launch 2 threads, and when I say I, it is the TestNG framework which is doing it for me. So I right click, run as TestNG. So can we see the output? If you maximize this, we have 2 threads executing, right? Of which one thread is executing this one, another one is executing this one, and the first one is executing this one, right? Is it clear? So what I have done with this is that I have said that please launch 2 threads for me, and that 2 threads will run on all the methods which are available in this class for me. Yes, no? Now what if I make it 3, what will happen? So let's see. Yes, we have 3, right? Now is the tricky question here. What if I make it 4? Then what will happen? How many threads will launch? Why not 4? Sure? Yes, I know, but are you sure about this? Yes, it will only launch 3 only, even if you have specified more than 3, and if there are not so many methods, then it will still run 3. Okay, so if you will see here 11, 12, 13, still it is. Is it clear? Let's see how we create this file. So for that, there is a concept of DTDs in Java. I will not go into that detail. So you people know what is an XML file, right? Yes, is there somebody who doesn't know XML file? XML file, everybody knows, right? So let me comment this and let's create from scratch. Now, if you put this entry here, what it does is, let me open this file for you, although this is to do with Java, but it's okay. I will open this URL for you. Okay, let me open this URL and I will paste it in browser here. So let's save this file. it is some DTD. It's okay. You don't have to understand this. It is out of syllabus, but still I'm telling you, it will help you in future if you want to dig deep into what we are trying to do. Okay, so if I go here, if I go inside this, if I copy this DTD, I copy it and I put it in XML. I'm putting it here so that I can show it to you. Okay, so let me put it here, for example, and let me open that file for you. So this has some tags. Don't worry about if you don't understand. If you understand, okay. If you don't understand, that is also okay. Okay, so you will see that it has some tags. One of the tag is a suit. Can anybody find suit? Suit. Once again, let me go from here. Okay, so this is a suit, right? It says that this is my DTD. What does DTD do? DTD defines that what all can go in the XML file. So this is a suit which can contain groups, listeners, packages, lot of things it can contain. And this is the root. So if I, okay, you don't even have to worry about that. Forget that. I'll say control space bar. So can I see an option of suit? So I'll hit enter. Yes. So my suit tag is created. Now how do I know what attributes? So let's name it some suit as my first suit, right? Now I'll say space here, control space bar. It allows me parallel. Yes, it is there. And I'll say METHOD, right? Yes. Then it is methods, right? And then control space bar TH thread count, and I get the count. Now what all can go inside this suit, I don't know. So I'll again say control space bar. So it gives me an option to choose a test, right? Yes. Inside the test, I give it a name, my TEST. Okay. Again, what all attributes go here, I don't know. So enabled, okay, I think so, this is fine, for we don't need to go. Now inside this test, what I can have control space bar again, classes, right? So in this classes, what can go? Control space bar class. Here I specify the name of the class. So was it difficult? Just by knowing how to use this feature, by adding this single line DTD here, we get to create this XML file. Yes, no. So what I am doing, I am mailing this file to you. Okay, I am mailing these two files to you, and for now I will give it in the group. I am mailing it to you, download it, execute it, and then generate the XML file by using control space bar feature. Is the question clear? Okay, so we'll continue further. Now in parallelism, next, please pay attention. So in parallelism, Shraddha, can you call those two guys? Please try it out later now. So next concept is classes. So remember there was an option to how do I know what all options are here? Control spacebar, these options are here, and I say classes here. And in the classes tag, I specify two classes now. One is this one, one is this one, right? So now what will happen? It will launch each class in a single thread. Is it clear? S2. So one, now we are not doing threading at method level, but at class level. So all the methods which are in that class, that will have the same thread. Another class will have same thread. Is it clear? So if I go to parallel class test one, so one is Firefox here. Let's say I do some execution of do this, do that. So it will launch one browser which is Firefox here, and the other one will launch Chrome for me, right? And then test cases, I've just done sys out. So if I run this, let's see what happens. Run as test ng suit. So one browser launched, means the first thread is running, which is Chrome. Okay, it is doing maximize, and then second one launched. Before the first got completed, second also started executing, right? So can you see both are doing their work? Is that right? Now if I go to the output and see what has happened. So if you go here in the output and see what has happened, let's see. So for this, okay, so now it has completed execution. So for this one, there is 12, 12, 12, right? Which is this class, 1, 1, 1. And the another one is this, 1, 1, 1, test, one second, test 1, test 1. Okay, I think so in the sysout I have not put it properly. So one was test 2, test 1, Firefox. Here I have put 1. So I should have put it here, this one. This and this, right? And the other one in the Chrome I will put copy two and two. Okay, and let me rerun it once again. Right click, run as test ng, and let's see the output of the console. Okay, so the next concept which we are going to look at is groups in test ng. So what happens, sometimes you can also group the test cases together. Grouping means you have 100 test case in a single file, out of which you might say one of the group is a regression group, another is let's say functional testing or load group or some kind of a group, or maybe this functionality group, right? So you have an option of even creating groups in test ng, and then you can choose to execute a certain group only. Okay, so how we are going to use this, let's see. Let's look at a simple example for that. So if you will go here in the groups here, okay, so first of all, let's look at the file here, group 1, right? So how do I define group? This I have already told you, right? In the brackets, say control space bar you will say groups option, right? And since it is groups, it means it is more than one. If it is more than one, it has to be an array, right? This is an array, isn't it? Is it? Who did not understand this point? If it is a groups, if it is more than one, it should be an array. That's why it is inside curly braces, right? We have done arrays already. Okay. Now I am saying that this particular test case is part of this group. This is part of these two groups. This is part of only one group, and this is part of two groups, right? Now when I create my suit here, which is, this is test group one. So is it this? Yeah. So here when I run this particular XML file, how did I get this control space bar? I did not, classes also we have done, but group we did not know, right? So for that, what I will do is, let me comment this and I will say control space bar. Do I see groups option? Yes. Inside the group option, what option I have? I have run only. I have others also, but run is there. Yes. Inside run, what option I have? I have include or exclude, right? So here I have chosen to include. So when I'm running this suit, I'm creating two test cases. One is sanity and one is regression. So for now, let's keep it very simple. I just want to run this one test case and only run those groups in this particular case, which is having name sanity, right? So if I go here, which of them has sanity? This has and this has. Okay, so let's run this and see what happens. Right click, run as test ng suit. So 1, 3 and 2. So it is 1, 3. Oh, sorry, it is, I'm looking at wrong class, sorry, my mistake. Okay, so this is the one, sanity, sanity and sanity, right? Yes. So because if I remove this sanity here, it will not run all the three, but it will only run one of them. Yeah, sorry, first and second, because it is included in the same group. Now what is the benefit and why do we do this is, sometimes when you have done a fix in your code, you don't want to execute all your test cases. You might want to create a group of test cases and then execute only that group. I mean, though we are running the test cases and it takes hardly few seconds to execute it, but in real world there will be like hundreds and thousands of test cases which will take hours and days to run. And for example, if you have made change in the first name of your project which you are working on, you might want to create a project of or a group of first name and then choose to execute only that particular group. Yes, clear? So this thing also you can try it from Bitbucket. I will not do it right away, but I hope the concept is clear to all of you, right? Include is basically from that file and include only this group. Exclude is that, yes, exclude that group. So for example, there were two here, right? If I exclude one and include another, because of exclusion this will also be excluded. Okay, so just play around with these combinations. This has two groups, right? If I say include sanity but exclude regression, a test case can be part of two groups, right? So if I exclude regression, then this also will get excluded because it is part of regression as well. Is it clear? Yeah. So we have looked at assertions, right? What is an assertion and what we do with assertions? So basically, the intention of purpose of using assertion is that you want to verify that expected and actual is correct, right? because in the case of manual, you sit in front and see whether it is working the way it should. But if it is a program doing it, then you have to use that assertion, right? Now, it might so happen that, let's say you write a test case, and in that test case you are checking 2-3 conditions, and if you are making use of assertions, then if the first condition fails, it will suspend the execution of that test case, right? It will not go to the next one. Like when exception happens, nothing after that executes. So it might so happen that you want to say that, okay, let it fail for some condition, I still want to continue for the rest of the test case which I have written. So that is where we make use of soft assertion. Soft assertion, what it is? Let me explain that with an example to you. So if you will go to this, I create an object of soft assertion. This is again a class of Java TestNG. And then I say assert equals true, 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 false, true, true. And then at the end, I say assert all. Now, if you were using a regular assert, if it fails here, it will not execute any line after this, right? But in this case, what it will do, it will execute rest of the code also. So what will happen? We will know that what has passed and what has failed for us, right? Rather than suspending, let's say it had to fail here, but at least it's telling me that it is passing at line number 17 as well. Is that right? So let me run this, run as TestNG. So let's go and see what has happened. So assertion failed, found expected true but found false, test case is failed. Okay, now if I go to this window here, what it is saying, line number 43, no, this is not that, this is failing here. Okay, hello, can you see the hello as an output here? So yes, hello is coming here as an output, right? Now just one more minute, remote TestNG main. So if I click on this, just 1 minute, I will just, so let's say I run this test case again, run as TestNG. So here the test case has failed, that is true, but it has also executed what was out beyond this particular failure, right? At line number 16 it failed. So that means this assertion also got executed, and therefore I mean, actually what I'm trying to look at is, I'm trying to soft assert org this. So how we know it's not giving a line number? I missed telling you one point here. So let me come back to that point and let's revisit my first basic was this one, right? So in this, not this one, this was my first test case which we ran, where I said that assert A B, right? So there is one more, this is a method overloaded method. It accepts one more argument here. Here if it fails, I can also display the message which is supposed to come if it failure happens. So I will say the values are not same, right? So if it fails, then this will display this message. If it passes, for example here, it will not display. So let me go back here again. I will say comma and this. So let's run it. I will change some AA and AB so that we know the difference. Okay, now this one passes, right? So it will never display this message. You want to see message only if there is a failure, is that right? But if it is passing, I don't want to worry about seeing the failure. So let's run it. Right click, run as. So let's see the output. AB values are not same, and this is coming only if it failed. If it passes, I will not get to see the message, right? So using this same concept, let's go back to the soft assert. So I will go here and I will put here whatever condition I wanted to put, failure 1. So it is failing due to condition 1, right? And the other one is failing due to failure 2 or condition 2. Failure 2. Is that right? Now if I run this, right click, run as, let's see what output we get. So here and here. Yes, so by looking at this, I at least know that these are the two cases for which it has failed, but out of those three cases, one has passed also, right? If this is also true, I will only see failure 1. Is that right? So do we understand the purpose of soft assert now? The purpose is that in case you want to execute, even if there is a failure, you want to test until the end, then you can go with soft assert. So the question is this: should we use, whether we can only use soft assert within a method or across different methods? It's a question to all of you. I have used in one method only, right? Suppose I copy and create one more method here. 2. Even I have not tried it, so I am trying it. So I am saying execute all the test cases in the file. Okay, let's not do it this way. This doesn't look seem to be a good idea, because anyway, if test case 1 is failing, still it is continuing. But you can use this approach if in two test cases you have different scenarios to test. So I am saying, remember we had before and after, before class after class, before test after test, right? So I can put this soft assert all at the before, or rather after method. So that after all are executed, then soft assert will happen. Is it clear? No? Yes? No? Assert all is basically, if you don't put assert all, the test case, this assertion will not happen. At the end, you should assert all so that all the assertions actually happen. Assertion. Okay, let's try without running, without that. Okay, so suppose I didn't put assert, let's run it. So it did not actually go ahead and do anything. It was as good as, it is as good as not putting any assertion here. For soft assert to work, you have to eventually says assert all, so that all this assertion happens. If I don't put it, everything is passing, meaning that it did not do the assertion actually, right? So did you understand the purpose of assert all? Now, I mean, it is a matter of choice whether you want to do in one method or multiple methods. It can depend upon your requirement. Okay. Then next topic in test NG is so next topic, and I hope that is the last topic for test NG, is parameterization. Parameterization is a concept wherein you can pass some parameters from XML file to the test case, and based on that parameter do this or that. For example, a good use case can be that you give the name of the browser you want to create. So you pass the parameter from XML file, and based upon the parameter, if it is Chrome or Firefox, it will create appropriate instance of that browser, and your test case execution will happen. Yes, no? So let's look at parameterization, how it works. Yeah, parameters here. So let's say I have this test case suit. Now we know that if you put it put this test, so how to write this test we know, right? So I am saying parameter name is this and value is this. How did I know this? Again, control space bar. Can you see parameter here with a name and a value, right? So this name should match the name of the method you are trying to call. So it is edureka-student, for example. If I go to parameter test file, so parameter test file is there. If you go here, there will be an edureka-student. Okay. So let me for now keep only one parameter here. Okay, let's collectively, so it is parameters. If it is parameters, it means it will go in curly bracket. Yes, yeah, that is an array. And here I am saying that one of the parameter is optional here. This first one is param1, @optional is param2. So this value gets assigned to this value gets assigned to this. Okay, but if it is optional, you may or may not pass it. But if you don't pass it, it is okay. But if you remove this, then it becomes mandatory to pass the second parameter also, right? So in this case here, you have to define edureka course parameter also. This student is there, edureka course also you have to define. So you can say like this, and you can say, right? And whatever course you want to give, or Selenium, right? So did we understand how parameters are used? Now what is the benefit, or how you can do? Sometimes you don't want to test the code, and based upon the input argument, suppose your manager says that boss, first go and execute in the Chrome, and then you execute by changing this parameter here, and based upon this parameter you create an instance of that browser here, Firefox or whichever it is, or Chrome or whichever it is, and then you can continue with the execution process. Is that right? Yes, no? Kaushik, clear? Atvir? Okay. Now coming back, understand one thing, that your ability to understand and use test NG extensively is going to be very, very useful. Why? Because you have seen that the true parallelism comes via test NG framework, right? I mean, you can pretty much do lot of things with test NG. Now let me bring up that project work which we are working on. So if I were in your place, and I would try to make use of as much as test NG features as available for the project work, right? So let's open the project work. So these are the major screens which we are working on. So if you go to courses, Selenium assignments. So this is what you are working on, right? Now I want to play around with it, and I want to write as much code as possible. I have my test cases all written and all that. So what I can do is I can create one class just to have different scenarios of name. That class will be doing validation for name only. Another will be doing validation only for labels of the name, and then one class for each of this. So I can then try to use the concept of parallelism of the classes to execute and see it works fine. Is that right? Or what I can do in one file, I can have multiple methods. I can try to create a group of first name and just execute that particular group. Or what I can do is I can have one class of Firefox, one of Chrome, and run classes in parallel to see whether it is working properly in both the browsers. Or I can pass parameter for all this from outside as well, right? From XML, right? That's even a better option. I don't want to hard code it. Yes, so it makes a lot of sense, isn't it? And if you put it all together, how much of Selenium we have done? I hardly spent a day or two in Selenium, right? Find element. I mean, of course, there is more Selenium coming, but then that's pretty much about it. If you know how to read HTML, if you know Java, you pretty much know Selenium. Yes? So that's all we have for TestNG. I will save this recording.